So first question. How many of you own your own businesses? Oh, great. How many of you manage people? How many of you are here because the boss said you had to go? Okay, so my name is Dave Ratner. As Max said, I do own a company called Dave's Soda and Pet City, and I'll explain briefly what it is because we don't have a lot of time. In 1975, I opened up a store in a vacant gas station selling all different brands of soda, Coke and Pepsi, at discount prices. I opened the store in Hadley, Massachusetts. If anyone knows the area, that's where Smith College, Mount Holyoke, UMass, Hampshire College, the list goes on and on, a gazillion different colleges. About a year later, it became painfully clear that I needed help meeting women. So I bought a puppy. So Bentley Beagle and I had a great time. It works, by the way, anyone who's interested. And one day, about a year later, I was buying pet food for Bentley, and I walked into the grocery store and I said, holy smokes, there's more pet food in there than there is soda. I went back to my corporate office, which was a telephone in the bathroom. I called Nine Lives and Purina, and I went into the pet food business. So today we have 7 stores. Soda is 2, count them, 2% of my business. Everything is pet related. And we just keep the soda so people will go, what do you do? What's the name of your company? So anyway, that's how we got to Soda and Pet City. So in what must have been clearly, as much the only way my wife can figure it, clearly in a need to lower the bar, yours truly was elected to the board of directors of the National Retail Federation. A few years ago was my first meeting, and here's a guy with 7 stores from Springfield, Massachusetts, walking into a room with truly the captains of industry, and we're all retailers here. So these are the gods of what I do for a living. They're people. They're just regular, normal people who I like to tell my friends, most of them just see stuff that we don't know exists. And I have been able to glean a lot of things from a bunch of the different retailers that I just want to go over with you. So the first one I want to talk about is Karen Katz. This is a great story. First meeting. I go in, I sit down at the table. I'm sitting next to this woman, Karen Katz. I quickly take out my phone, sort of lean over to the side, call my wife, and say, you're not going to believe this. I'm sitting next to the CEO of Neiman Marcus. My wife says, get a coupon. So for all the women who are in the audience, I know you're not going to believe this story. A few years ago, my daughter got married in Atlanta. My wife Ellen and I, just to take a break, got away from the hotel. We went over to Phipps Plaza or whatever it is, Lenox, and we were walking through Neiman Marcus. And ladies, here's the part you're not going to believe. While we were walking through the jewelry department, I was able to convince my wife she needed a piece of jewelry. Right? Imagine that. So I bought Ellen a piece of jewelry. We were treated beyond, and not an expensive piece of jewelry, but we were just treated like royalty. I wrote Karen an email telling her what a nice experience I had in her store. So here's the first lesson. Karen shot an email back to the store, to all the employees, telling them what a great experience in the store that one of her friends had. So for me, the two lessons are, number one, whenever someone says something nice about one of your crew, make sure everybody knows about it. Here's the second lesson, which just sort of came to me. For those of us who manage part-time people, how many of you have part-time workers for, right? And for, you know, people that, how do you motivate them? The lesson I learned from this was, I tell all the folks who work for me,
The number one reason to provide excellent customer service has nothing to do with the company. The number one reason to provide excellent customer service is you never know who you're waiting on. And guess what? That resonates with my part-timers, it resonates with the kids in school, and it resonates with the folks who are in full-timers. So I'm going to embarrass someone who just happens to be sitting in the audience. Brian Devine is the chairman of Petco. He is one of the most gracious, nicest guys that I have ever met. When I was put on the board, he was the first one to come over and welcome me, introduce me to other people. There's also another board member in the room, Keith Lippert, who told me what a great mentor that Brian has been to him. The lesson that I get from Brian is, there is no such thing as ego. No matter how far you have gotten, remember who you are and where you came from. So last year at this meeting, I went to Brian and said, Brian, I'm struggling with, and I assume you all have the same struggle, I'm struggling with raising prices. Is anyone like me, you hate to raise prices in your store? I get so nervous that I'm going to lose all my customers. I said, how do I do it? And Brian said to me, just don't raise the prices over 8%. So I don't know what business you're in, but I will tell you that when I got home from NRF last year, that's how much we raise prices when we have to go up. Not a nickel more than 8%. This is a fellow who is not a titan of retail, but he's the best HR person that I know. This is going to be, you're going to love this one. Our business got to the point where with 7 stores, we had to start borrowing money from the bank. And the bank started requiring financials, and we became a real business. I opened a wholesale business, and the bank said, you can't have a bookkeeper anymore. You need to get someone in the office so we can get figures. So I went to Rick to help me find someone, and we've always had a bookkeeper. And Rick said to me, here's how I want you to start hiring people, which is a great lesson for independent retailers. If you're doing, I'm going to pick a number, $5 million, and you want to grow, and you need a manager or a bookkeeper or whatever it is, hire someone who's run a $10 million company. Always hire someone who runs a company bigger than your company. Otherwise, you can't grow. What a duh, right? Brian Wolf is a consultant. He was a COO of Coca-Cola. He was the first one to, he was the one who put into play charging your better customers less than your regular customers. He was the first one, or one of the first ones, to get grocery stores to start putting in loyalty programs to track what customers buy. So I read an article in one of the direct marketing magazines about that Brian wrote about doing that, and I called him. Which is another thing that we have to do as entrepreneurs and business owners is you got to do stuff that most people wouldn't do, which we clearly do anyway because we started our own businesses. And I called Brian. And I said I introduced him. Myself to Brian. I said, Brian, can I afford your services to help me get my database going and all that stuff? And Brian said, absolutely not. I charge like, you know, $1 million a day. And he laughed. He said, tell me about your business. I told him about my business. He says, my mother-in-law lives in 2 towns over from you. I'll be there next week. Let's go have lunch. So Brian told me how to set up my loyalty program. How many of you capture customer contact information? You all have to capture customer information. To build a relationship with your customers, you have to know who they are, where they live, what they like to buy, right? To me, customers are like dating. Customer comes in the store the first time, they have a great shopping experience. You go on a date, you have a great time on your date. If you don't have your date's phone number or contact information, you can't call them back to say, can we do this again? Great lesson. Have you ever gone into a store and they say, would you like to give us your email? And the first thing you say is what? No. Right? However, how many of you have a dog or a cat? Brian, look around the room. How many of you have a dog or a cat? Right. Would anyone like to get an email to know if what they were feeding their dog or cat was on a recall? Raise your hands. Right. Think your customers want to have emails? They love to hear from you about stuff that's important to them. What you have to train your folks to do is not say, would you like to sign up for our email list? You have to train them to say, here's a reason why. Let me sign up for my email list, so in case there's a recall, sign up for our email list in case what you buy goes on sale, we'll let you know. And I promise, and here's where independent retailers, here's the advantage that we have. Your customers come to you because they trust you. So everything has to be personalized. This is all stuff I learned from Brian. He said, make sure you promise on your children's soul that you will not sell those emails. You will not violate the trust of your customer. Pretty good stuff. So I am also in another organization called Young Presidents Organization, although I'm clearly not young anymore. We're now in the old persons organization. And we went to a retail seminar, and Demos was talking. Demos is the president operations of Staples. So if you think about it, at one point, Staples was closing, their retail stores. They were in transition. So Demos' advice to us was, your business is always changing. He said, when we opened Staples, think about what a Staples or a Best Buy was 15 years ago. Aisles of software titles, right? Aisles of DVDs, aisles of computers and printers, all the stuff that we now buy online. So he said, times have changed. We had to build an e-commerce site, and we had to close stores that were too big. So he said, the lesson is you have to look at how things are progressing, and you always have to have your business in a mode that you can change. What's next? So this is a very special friend of mine. Julie Gardner, who probably won the record for the longest running CMO of a big company. She was the CMO of Kohl's for I don't even know how many years. So how many of you get like me? You open up the Sunday paper and you look in and you see flyers from your competition? Raise your hands. Anybody? Do you get the sinking feeling that, oh my God, we're going to do no business this week because my competitor has a flyer with all these products, right? Are you shaking your head, Matt? You get that? I panic every time I see it. I get the knot in the stomach, right? So I called Julie. I said, Julie, I don't get this. Every time I run a flyer, tell me if I'm right or wrong. Every time I run a flyer, I never get an ROI. Anyone with me? All right, so I'm the only one who does it. Make me feel like an idiot. I said, how is that possible? She said, do not run flyers. She said, they're profit centers for the big guys. You can't run flyers. Contact your customer list. Let them know what they use is on sale. Do targeted marketing. You can't afford to do the shotgun. So that's number one from Julie. I don't know how many hundreds of millions of dollars that Julie was in charge of. I don't know what Kohl's ad budget is, but can you imagine what their ad budget is? They probably spend more in a week than most of us do in a year in business, right? So I said to Julie, what makes a good salesperson? How do you decide? Because everybody wants a piece of Julie. She said, well, the first rule is, and this to me is really interesting, everyone has to be, who calls on us, has to be respectful. That's the first rule. And she said, the best reps, and this is what we have to do for our customers, the best reps always bring a value added to the table. Right? So what in your store can you bring to your customers that's a value added? Every store has to have one. Laura Sen. Laura Sen, I guess she just retired, was the CEO, I just saw that in the board notes because she's not going to be at the meeting, was the CEO of BJ's Wholesale Club. Reasonably large company. They do, I think, $11 billion, which is a little bit more than I do. If you Google Laura Sen, all you will see in Google is talking about kindness, talking about being one of the crew, and talking about how you have to be nice. I mean, just pages and pages and pages of what Laura's reign at BJ's was about. Here's a great story. 2 years ago at NRF, I said to Laura, do you want to come out for dinner with me and my wife? Laura says, I'd love to, but a girlfriend of mine is coming in and we're gonna go to a show. So I said, great, where are you staying? Okay? She does $11 billion a year. Where are you staying, Laura? You ready? The Comfort Inn. I said, are you kidding? How can you stay at the Comfort Inn? Here's the part that I love. She said, I'm on company time. We're a membership discount club. I can't stay anywhere else. And then she says, it gets even better. My friend is splitting the room with me. Right? So when I asked some people who I knew at BJ's, I said, tell me about what Laura is. Well, Laura eats in the company lunchroom every day for lunch. Laura is one of the crew. So I know, and this is what I've taken from Laura, that if we're the owner, we're the manager, whatever it is, we have to be the same as everybody else on our team. Right? You just have to do it. Where is it? I'm not clicking. Oh, there we go. So this is a gentleman by the name of Chris Daniel, who's the president of Destination Maternity, which is, they are the folks who own Pee in the Pod and a bunch of other sites that cater to women who are having babies. He's not on an NRF board member, but I met him. I was lucky enough to meet him. And we were at a CEO roundtable, and again, don't ask me how I got invited. I was like the token person there, smallest business in the room. He has about 200 employees at his corporate. And then we were talking about culture. And he said, I take every new employee out for coffee when they come to work, which I think is brilliant. Says it lets me articulate the vision of the company, what we want from them, and I get to know them, and they love it. What a duh, right? How many of us have taken our employees out for coffee to see what's going on in the company? I think it's just a great idea to get out of the store. One of my favorites. So here's a question. How many of you have children? Raise your hands. Not everybody. How many of you had mothers? Almost everybody. Okay. How many of you remember your mothers telling you to write thank you notes? story. Second NRF board meeting is in Washington. We're going to Capitol Hill to lobby the senators, which is what we do. I'm with Mindy and Laura Sen and a couple of other people. We're chit-chatting because we don't really know each other. I give Mindy my business card, and we just sort of hit it off. And as we went to our first meeting, and as we're walking in the bowels of Capitol Hill, which is very cool, I don't know if many of you have done that, Mindy stops and puts her hand on my shoulder and says to me, "I'll bet you have your own brand of pet food, don't you?" I said, "Yeah." End of discussion. We go to our meetings. The day is over. Hugs and kisses. Goodbye. She goes to Florida. I go back. We'll see you. You know, we'll see you next January at the next meeting. Here's the lesson. I write a handwritten, nice to meet you note to Mindy, not an email. A handwritten note. I must have mailed it on a Monday. Mindy must have gotten it on Tuesday. Wednesday morning at 9 o'clock, my phone rings. "Hi, this is Chris Nakora. Mindy just left my office and told me I need to put a deal together with you to start selling your dog food on Home Shopping Network." Seriously? He says, "Yeah." He said, "You need to come down and meet the team." So I fly down to, I email Mindy and say, "I'm going to be down on whatever date. I'd like to buy you and your husband dinner." She says, "Nonsense, you'll be my guest at such and such a restaurant. Be there at 7:30. I show up at 7:30. She's there with her husband, who runs a hedge fund. What else would he do? And a bunch of other people. We have dinner. I'm sitting next to Mindy. Here's the part. I say to Mindy, "How do you compete against QVC? Mindy does, at that time, 3 million. QVC does 6 million. She says, "When I got to HSN, the place was a mess. There was no culture, there was no nothing." So the first thing I did is I went to employee orientation, just like every other new employee does. And then I had a town meeting and I made my vision of the company clear. And here's my vision of the company. This is what all independent retailers have to do. It is our job to make the customers fall in love with us. If you're going to buy a tablecloth, you're going to buy the tablecloth from the person who wove it or invented it or something. There has always got to be a story. You're going to fall in love with the presenter. We're going to offer an unconditional money-back guarantee. We're going to take all the risk away, which I think is so important for us. Take all the risk away from doing business with us, and you're going to love us. So we've all been there. I said, "I get it. I understand." And my mind is just going how we need to do that in our stores, all of us independent retailers. So the next morning when I met the buying team, because I'm such a pain in the neck, I said, "So what's it like working here?" To all of them. They all repeated what Mindy said, every single one of them. It's all about the story, right? It's not about the product. It's about getting people to fall in love with us. And so then I'm thinking, the all about the story part is really important. In our stores, and when I say ours, I'm talking ours, retailer stores, instead of, for example, just having signs with products, we should have stories about the products. Customers are coming to our stores to become emotionally involved with what we do. Right? Think about it. Not just price and product. Involve the customer. The coolest part for me is that once again, like Laura, she's just one of the people. But to articulate the vision of your company. So now I'm going to ask the age-old question. This is my most favorite question to ask any audience. How many of you have someone back home that you know you should fire? Raise your hands. Right? Fire them as soon as you get home. Blame it on me. I'll take the hit. If they don't buy into what you have articulated, how you want the company run, you got to get rid of them. That's what happened at Home Shopping Network. They are now just killing it. They're doing phenomenal. But they all buy into that one culture. Let's see. Oop. Okay. This is a guy by the name of Richard Baker, who is, as you can see, he's the CEO of Hudson Bay, and they bought Saks Fifth Avenue. So he was at another talk that I was at, and the question, it was at Saks right after they bought it. And the question was put to him, do you have anything, any plans for the flagship store? The flagship store, if you want to get jealous, is 600,000 square feet. They do $1,000 a foot in revenue. So $600 million out of one store. So Richard said, you know, we do $600 million out of the store, but we're not happy with it at all. We want to do what Harrods does, which is $3,000 a foot. Okay? How are we going to do that? He said, well, we've been kicking around ideas. He said, what do you think about taking one whole floor and making it into handbags? Women, would you come to New York and not want to go to Saks? Right? He said, we think that every woman who in the world who would come to New York would want to come to Saks to see the handbag collection. So I'm thinking, as an independent retailer, what in your store do you have that nobody else has? Right? We all have to have something in our stores, a reason for customers to come to our store rather than the competitor's store. So in two of my stores, just for example, we have the world's tallest cat trees. We have cat people coming from all over the place. I was at a trade show. I swear to God, the cat tree is about as tall as that column. I walked by. I said to the guy in the booth, I said, how much is that cat tree? He said, I don't know. We've never sold one. I said, I'll take two. He said, but I don't know how much they are. I said, great, I'll take two. I'm a real good bargainer. About 2 months later, they showed up in my store. My controller, no longer bookkeeper, came in and said, are you out of your effing mind? Did you see what you just paid for these things? I closed my eyes. I signed the check. I have no idea. But people come from all over to see the world's biggest cat trees. So I challenge you. What do you have in your store that your competitors don't, that someone will come and make a special trip to see? How many of you have heard of Stu Leonard? So Stu Leonard has some stores, started out in Connecticut, and he has a rule that I'm going to get a little bit wrong, but the rule is basically the customer is always right. That's A. B, if you think the customer is not right, reread the first part. So Stu Leonard built stores, grocery stores, but specialized in, you can't get 8,000 SKUs. He did stuff, talk about what you can't get at other stores. They bottle milk in the store. They make ice cream in the store. And these are huge stores. So his stores are a real destination for people to shop. His culture with his employees is exactly what Mindy did. If you don't buy into the culture, you can't work there. The customer is always right. So here's a little, what I think, for independent retailers. A lesson that I learned from Stu. Two things. How many of you do good things for your communities? Almost everybody, right? We all do really good things for our communities. We're guilty of not letting the communities know what we do. Every single good thing that you do should be plastered all over your store. Signs, posters, emails, your Facebook page, whatever you do. Everyone should know all the good stuff that you do. This year, we donated a bunch of money to a shelter. We took away our register mats. Everyone's got little mats on their cash registers, cash and wraps, right? We took away ours, and we had a picture of me handing the check to the shelter as our cash register little mat that people put their stuff down on. So think what you do in your store, that you can do that. And an independent business, that's how we bond with our customers. Another great story. So Terry Lundgren, to me, he's the man, right? You think retail in the U.S., it's Terry Lundgren. Now, it had been 2 years since I'd been on the board. I'd never really spoken to Terry except for Hi Hawaiian. I'm like intimidated, right? This is God. So there was a shop.org conference in Chicago. There was an impromptu board meeting. And Brian, you're going to love this. And I am sitting next to Terry at dinner. So we start talking. What do your kids do? They're people, right? Blah, blah, blah. So he says to me, yeah, I have a daughter who lives out in California. I say, what does she do? He says, I can't tell you. I said, okay, now you got to tell me. He says, she's in charge of associate training at Petco. So we have a great laugh, right? I get home. I write a handwritten, nice to meet you note to Terry. This guy has 175,000 employees, I think, right? 2 days later, I get a handwritten, nice to meet you note, thanks for your note, from Terry. He's got time to write the note. A few weeks later, I'm at a Mass Retail Association board meeting, and the government person who does government affairs for Macy's is at the meeting. So I tell him, I say, you're not going to believe this, that, you know, I told him the story with Terry. He looks at me and he says, my mom died last year. I got a handwritten note from Terry. He has 175,000 employees. My guess is that all of us here have fewer. Writing those notes to your employees is a huge deal. Right? We sometimes forget to do this kind of stuff. It is a huge deal. So here's the quote that I told one of my buddies. You need charisma before you can influence. Right? You need charisma. So the job as owners and managers is do these nice little things so you can influence people. Just another quick. My kid is a musician. He writes a song called I'd Rather Be With My Dogs Than Be With You. He goes on Facebook and says, everybody send in pictures of your dogs, because you got to do a video, right? So he gets hundreds of pictures of dogs. He's looking at the computer and he says to me, you know what? I think this is life is good. So he calls a t-shirt manufacturer and has t-shirts made that say, I'd rather be with my dog with different breeds on them, and I'd rather be with my cat. So I know that this is a very cool thing. The year before, Macy's in San Francisco took all their merchandise out of their windows for Christmas and put in puppies and kittens that were up for adoption. How cool is that? I think it's cool for two reasons. Number one, he let the local store do what they wanted to do, but it was a huge deal with the community. So I emailed Terry, because now I have a relationship with him because I wrote that note. I never would have done it before. I email Terry and say, Terry, my kid's got these shirts. What buyer should he talk to? I think Macy's could do well with these. 20 seconds later, I get an email. Hi, Dave, good to hear from you. Doug will hear from someone on my team shortly. 9 o'clock the next morning, Douglas hears from the executive vice president of the world or someone from Macy's. Says, Terry told me to email you. I was on your site. I think maybe we can do something. Let's set up a conference call. Douglas says, great. They set up the call. Then my kid says, you know what? I'm going to be in New York anyway. Can we do it in person? The guy says, sure. Be here, whatever it was, Friday at 11:15. So Douglas goes in, very smart, finds out what kind of dog this guy has, and has a T-shirt, custom T-shirt made, and a mug for the guy, right? He did that on his own. Takes after his mother. So his meeting is at 11:15. At 11 o'clock, he calls me and says, I think I'm in the boardroom. So he has a meeting with all the big shots at Macy's, right? And Macy's takes in the shirts. And this whole thing, they had to love the shirts. The whole thing never would have happened if I didn't write the note. That's the key. So this is a fellow, Tom Frick is, you've never heard of HMS Host. That's the company that manages many of the restaurants and gas stations, but when you on the turnpikes and in the airports. So all the Starbucks and all the Burger Kings and McDonald's. So we were at another CEO forum, and we were talking about adversity. And Tom's advice, which to me, probably out of all this advice, was just stuff that I never thought about. He has 25,000 employees. He said when he first started out his career, this is a great idea, he used to write on the anniversary date of the employees working there, he would write a note, not on their birthday date, but on their anniversary date. He was able to do that when he didn't have, he can't do it with 25,000 employees, but I'm guessing that you and I can do that with our employees. That's the first thing. Second thing he said is, any of you ever have adversity in your organizations, or is it just me? Right? We have adversity, whatever it is. Managers are managers because they need to make decisions. The worst managers don't make decisions. Your crew is looking for you to get them out of a situation or to help them navigate it. So do not waffle and always make a decision. Third thing, never lose your temper in front of your employees. Never. He said, unless it's planned, and he said, in 30 years, I've lost my temper once when it was planned. So we all said, what do you do? It's impossible not to get angry once in a while. He said, I literally go into the bathroom, sit in a stall, take out my phone, and look at pictures of my kids when they were little. Never lose your temper. Here's the one that you don't think about. Said, do you have any idea what your mood and your manager's mood does to the whole morale of everyone in your organization? So when you're in a bad mood, do you show it to your crew? Because they're going to be in a bad mood. So always have you and your folks be level. No bad moods. Leave your problems at home. A couple years ago, Tony either got an award or whatever, but he was here, and at lunch, I was fortunate enough to sit at the table, and of course, we're now on first name basis, although I don't think he knows my name. I just know he's Tony. But Tony is from Zappos. And here's the lesson to learn from Zappos. Zappos was going bankrupt. They had burned through millions and millions and millions of dollars. They surveyed their customers and said, what would it take for you to buy from us? Anyone know what the answer was? Free shipping and free returns. How many of you buy from Zappos? Free shipping, free returns, right? Right. So the point is, how many of us have contacted our customers to say, what else can we sell you? What would make you shop with us? What can we do that our competitors don't do? I think it's brilliant, right? Here's the other thing that he did. In 2010, when the world was still falling apart and businesses were pulling in inventory, they were cutting out lines, he expanded what Zappos was carrying because no one else was doing it. So he opened up all these new lines of businesses because of the rest of the world was contracting them. Right? Brilliant. So for us, if times are bad in A, what can we do with B? I bet everybody's foot traffic is down. Right? Am I right? I know mine is. How do we reinvent ourselves? What can we do that our competitors don't do? So you have to always be, and you know what? I salute you because you're here, not necessarily in my session, but you're here to learn how to make your business be better, right? So I'm sort of preaching to the crowd. So this is one of my favorite quotes. I have not met him, but I saw him and I thought, this is just such a very, very cool quote. So the two last things that I want to leave you with is the most important things for me, I said it before, is a culture, having a culture at your place of work that, taken from Laura, people are decent, people respect each other, that if someone doesn't buy into the culture, they can't work there. That's how HSN turned itself around, and if you ever run into Mindy or anyone who works at HSN, she'll be the first person to tell you that's how we did it. Always, always, always compliment your crew. Never, never, never come down on them in front of other people, right? And never, which is so hard for folks who own their own businesses, never lose your temper. Never. And always make decisions when those tough times come up. Get the input of your crew. Here's the last thing that I learned. You probably didn't think about this. Your crew is going to want to know what you saw at the show. So everything that you got excited about, anything that you had questions about, go back, tell your crew, tell your customers, get them involved in what you did here for the last couple days. Right? Simple. And then write thank you notes. So much of the world, nobody does it. Your competitors don't do it. Here's a little trick. Write those thank you notes to your ad reps and to your vendors. And then when they have a little extra money for ads or for a special deal, guess who they think about first? So we have exactly 1 second left. Thank you very much. If anybody's got questions, I'll be right over there. Thank you, folks. Have a great show.